In this video, we're going to apply energy ideas along with equilibrium ideas to figure out a bunch of things. Okay, so I'm going to repeat one of the problems but with variables in this one, and then we're going to try to figure out the equilibrium length first, and then we will also figure out what happens when you look at this mass of block M, okay? When we attach this mass to the spring, when the spring is completely unstretched, and we let go of this mass. And what we understand is that if you let go of this mass is going to oscillate. It's going to go down and then go up, and it's going to go up and down and up and down. It's going to oscillate about some position. We'll figure out what that position is. But before that, what we'll do is we'll quickly calculate the equilibrium position of the block. Okay. Now, there's something interesting that one must keep in mind when we're talking about equilibrium. Realize that if I have a spring that is attached, if I have a spring and it's unstretched length, and if I were to attach a block to the spring, what the block would do is that it would stretch the spring out. And for us to make sure that the block is in equilibrium, which means it does not move, okay, we need to exert some external force on the block. So it could be the hand, it could be that there's a hand that is holding this block, and it slowly allows the block to come down, and once we realize that the block's not going down anymore, we let go of the hand and the block is in equilibrium. So there is some external force that is in play. We don't really care about this external force, but it's important to realize that there is something outside of gravity and the spring that's happening. Once we let the block go, then what we know is that the block is in equilibrium, and there are two competing forces here. We have the force of gravity, which is trying to pull it down, which is mg, and then the spring force, which is F sub s equals kx, that is trying to pull it up. Again, we do not put the negative sign here, because by identifying the direction of the spring force, we've already accounted for the negative sign. Okay, so that is kx, and we can equate the two, and that gives us mg equals kx, and so this gives us x equals mg divided by k. So this is the equilibrium extension for the spring. So from here, the spring extends by an amount x, which you call mg over k. Alright, now that we have this, let's go back to our problem and let's try to figure out what this y is. Okay, now here we cannot use equilibrium ideas, because what we know is that we let go of this block at this point. So it's never an equilibrium. Okay, it will be in equilibrium at some point, but it doesn't stay there. It's going to keep moving. So we cannot use equilibrium ideas. We're going to rely on energy ideas. We're going to rely on mechanical energy conservation to figure out the speed at the bottom. Now what we know is that in the beginning, the block is at rest. It's not moving. The spring is unstretched as well. So when we talk about the initial mechanical energy, we have to get the mechanical energy for the block and for the spring. For the block, we have both kinetic and potential. And for the spring, since it's massless, all we have is the spring potential energy. In the beginning, the spring has no potential energy because it's unstretched. The block has no kinetic. However, the block is at its highest point, and so the block will have some kind of potential energy. At the bottom here, the spring now has potential energy. The block has nothing. It's at its lowest point. It is instantaneously at rest, and it also has no PE. So we know all these things now, and let's apply this. Let's figure out what the ends up being. So to find y, we're going to use MEI equals MEF. As we said, in the beginning, the block is not moving. So 1/2 times m times 0. The block does have potential energy, and since it is at a height y, the unknown quantity, okay, we're going to put that there, and then the spring ends up having no potential energy, and that is because it is unstretched. So once again, the first two terms are for the block, and this term is for the spring. Okay, and the final mechanical energy is simply going to be equal to 1 half times m times 0 squared, once again, because it's address, plus 0 for the potential. So this is all for the block again. Now the spring is what has some kind of energy. It's 1 half times k times y squared. So if you didn't hear that, the final is the potential energy for the block, which is 0 for kinetic and 0 for potential, and or rather the mechanical energy for the block, and this is the potential energy or the mechanical energy for the spring. And since the spring has no mass, we only worry about the kinetic energy for the spring. Alright, so let's combine all this, and what we end up getting is that mg times y is equal to 1 half times k times y squared. Alright, solving this is easy. We can get rid of one of the y's. The square goes out, and then what we end up getting is y is equal to 2 times mg over k. Alright, so this is how far the block drops. So let's put this all into a picture here. So what we have is, this is the unstretched length of the spring. Now we attach a mass out here. Okay. And what we notice is that once you attach the mass, the spring is going to oscillate, the mass rather is going to oscillate between these two positions. This distance is y, which is twice mg over k. Now if you look at what x was equal to mg over k. The equilibrium extension was mg over k, which is about here. So what we know is that as this mass moves up and down, it oscillates about its equilibrium position. Okay? Which is, this is not the unstretched length of the spring, but the equilibrium position for that block. And that will always be a property, something that we'll use a lot. Alright? So this is application of mechanical energy along with spring ideas.